Welcome to the Azure AD Architecture Deep Dive Series. I am Ramiro Calderon. I'm a program manager in the Azure AD engineering team here at Microsoft.
Hello, my name is Carissa Copemans, and I'm also a program manager on the Azure AD engineering team.
So in this video, we're going to cover four ways to provision external identities using Azure Active Directory B2B collaboration. In this first scenario, we have Anne from Contoso over here, and she wants to add Bob to work in Microsoft Teams. He is an employee of Fabricam, which is also an Azure Active Directory tenant. In this context, we call Contoso the resource tenant because that's where the applications are. And Fabricam is the account tenant because that's where the external identity is. Creating external users has two parts. The part one is invitation. The second part is what we call redemption. The invitation phase of the flow starts when Anna adds Bob to Microsoft Teams. Under the covers, Teams calls the invitation backend service to create an invite request for Bob. The invitation service validates that the request is not in the allow deny list of tenants, whether the external user is already created, and other validations. So when the validations pass, then the service creates a user object in the resource tenant here in step two. The user then is marked as a pending state until the flow is completed. A key thing to note here is that the moment that Bob's user object is created in the resource tenant, then it can be added to groups, you can change attributes, etc. So in step three over here, Bob needs to complete the provisioning process, again, and we're transitioning to the redemption phase of the invitation process. In our Teams example, Bob will get an email with a link to access Teams. Bob also could have gone straight to the resource if he knew the link to it. This works for any other application the same way. In step four, the authentication does the homegrown discovery. So this is exactly as the other follows that we did before. The user needs to type in the UPN, and in this case, Bob is going to type bob@fabricam.com. Now we have two pieces of data. We know that the resource is in Contoso, and the user account is in Fabricam. Since both of these things are recognized by the authentication service as Azure AD tenants, then the authentication systems can validate if there is a user in Contoso that represents Bob. In this case, there's a user, but it's in pending state over here per step number two before. With this information, the authentication service moves to step five over here to figure out how to authenticate Bob. The credential challenge kicks in here in step number six, depending upon the configuration of Fabricam. So if they're using ADFS or password hash sync, et cetera. In step six, Bob enters the credential per the configuration. In step seven, Azure AD validates the credentials where the user account is coming from. In this case, the account tenant Fabricam. Since the authentication validated that Bob is in Contoso and is in a pending redemption state, the authentication service redirects the user to the invitation backend service here in step eight. That allows Bob to consent sharing information with Contoso through a user experience. This consent experience is in place to fulfill regulatory compliance such as GDPR. And then after Bob consents, that triggers the last step in the flow where the invitation backend service populates a special attribute. And we call it AltSecID. That's short for Alternate Security Identifier. The AltSecID is a piece of metadata that indicates that Bob's credentials are not in the Contoso tenant, but instead, the credentials need to be found in the Fabricam tenant. At this point in time, the provisioning flow is completed, and the user is no longer marked as pending. Then Bob can go and access Microsoft Teams and any other application or resources he has access to. Carissa, would you like to walk us through the next scenario?
Yes, thanks, Ramiro. So, user objects can also be provisioned with a social ID, for example, Gmail. The flow is very similar, except instead of having users from two different tenants in Azure AD, you have Anne from Contoso, the resource tenant, inviting Bob, who has a Gmail account. For this to work, the Contoso administrator has to configure Gmail as an identity provider. So, steps 1 through 5 are exactly the same as the previous diagram. Azure AD Authentication Services then has the ability to go and talk to Gmail, redirecting the user to authenticate with Gmail using OAuth. In step 6, Bob interacts with the social IDP through OAuth and sends a token back to Authentication Services. And in step 7, the social IDP token is validated. After validation, step 8 and 9 are exactly the same. So, if this wasn't exciting enough, there is more.
In the next diagram, we have external identity provision with direct federation. This is a good fit for cases where Contoso needs to collaborate with an organization that doesn't have an Azure AD tenant, but may have a federation service that supports SAML or WS federation protocols. For this example, let's say Bob is now in fabricantagency.com, and that's a company that doesn't have an Azure AD tenant, but they have an ADFS somewhere. The information about the federation service, the certificates, and the domain, et cetera, that has to be configured ahead of time by the Contoso administrator. The first five steps of the flow are identical to the previous ones. In step six, the authentication service redirects the user to the federation service per the configuration. So in this case, it's going to talk to ADFS. After Bob authenticates, it will send a SAML assertion back to the authentication service. In step seven, Azure AD authentication service will validate the SAML assertion. And then after that, steps eight and nine are exactly the same as the previous cases.
The last scenario that we're going to cover is the email one-time passcode, or EOTP, which is a proof of possession of an email address to authenticate the user. This option allows customers to collaborate with anyone who has an email address, but can't use any of the other three options we discussed before. This flow also needs to be enabled by the administrator. So, referring to the diagram, steps 1 through 5 are identical to the previous flows. In step 6, the authentication service generates a one-time passcode and uses a high-performing messaging service to send the OTP to Bob's email. Bob can then retrieve the OTP from his email, and we validate the OTP in step 7. Again, the last steps are the same. Bob consents to sharing with Contoso, and an AltSec ID is populated.
Here are some key takeaways for external identity provisioning. Resource tenant owns the external user object lifecycle. They can add him to groups, change attributes, or anything else that you can do with a user object. The external user owns the credential. All four techniques that we saw today allow you to collaborate with pretty much anybody without creating local accounts for external users. The flow is exactly the same across all the scenarios. The technique to authenticate the external user is the only thing that changes. Tenant-to-tenant invitation works by default, but all the other three methods need to be configured by the administrator ahead of time. We want to thank you for joining us today. We hope you found this video useful. We'll be adding more videos on different topics over time, so please see the description below for additional information.
Thank you.